Ed Lambeth Field is where the Virginia Cavaliers once played, part of a long and rich football history. But today brings something Charlottesville has never seen.
Are you ready?
Oh, yeah.
Are you ready?
Oh, yeah.
The shocking speed touchdown Ducks. Look at this speed.
I told you don't blame.
Number two, Oregon, and its blur of an offense has come to town. It's the ACC on ESPN. The number two Oregon Ducks have flown east to ACC country for their first true test of 2013, the Virginia Cavaliers. Good afternoon, everybody. Mike Patrick, Ed Cunningham. It's great to have you with us. Janine Edwards will join us shortly. Virginia got a big win last week against a good BYU team. That should give them some confidence coming in against Oregon. But remember this, those Cougars and these Ducks are entirely different animals.
And these Ducks come into this game 24-point favorites. So a lot of people around the country thinking, what is it, 1 in 100 that this game goes Virginia's way? Well, that's why we play them. And unfortunately for me, as a junior at the University of Washington, and Ducks fans will love this, we got to number two in the country and played an unranked UCLA team at home favored by 22 points. We lost. It cost us a national championship that year. And the bad news for Mark Helfrich, as he brings this team in the first time, first-year head coach taking over for Chip Kelly, you lose this game, and in the last year of the BCS, the two-team playoff, I think you're out of the national championship discussion.
Virginia takes the field in front of a near sellout crowd. When you look at Oregon, there is no doubt they are loaded with skill players. They racked up 772 yards in total offense last week. This is fast break basketball on grass.
It's really cool how these offenses have changed the sport, and especially Oregon. And of course, they still have Marcus Mariota, who comes in, a lot of people thinking the Heisman favorite. He was a little off last week. Let's see if he gets his accuracy back. DeAnthony Thomas, of course, one of the most explosive players in all of college football. But the scary thing about Oregon is every time they play, you see a new guy come up. Talking to the coaches, Braylon Addison looks like the next guy. Looking at him on film last week, looks like the next guy who may be great in space for these Ducks.
Oregon ready for the first road game of the Mark Helfrich era. Janine Edwards talks with the new coach of the Ducks after the break. Then it's time for kickoff in Charlottesville. Marcus Mariota and DeAnthony Thomas are back with Oregon, and their old offensive coordinator has a new role. We'll have Mark Helfrich and Janine Edwards talking about that later. DeAnthony Thomas at the goal line. Speed to burn, but the Cavaliers swarm him at the 10-yard line. Great kick coverage by Virginia. DJ Hill, a backup linebacker, flying downfield to make the tackle. Marcus Mariota put up incredible numbers a year ago as a freshman. 32 touchdowns passing, a Pac-12 freshman record. 38 total touchdowns. That was a school record. He also rushed for 752 yards. He is an incredible talent. They try to get the screen to DeAnthony Thomas.
And Mariota, after last week's performance, albeit against Nicholls State, a lot of people saying maybe going up in the Heisman candidate conversation, but the truth is, did not play great last week. His throws early were off target quite often, had a little foot issue. They worked with his timing. Let's see if he cleans that up against a better defense.
Bryson Marshall, his tailback right now. Instead, the pass to the sideline to Lyrla, the tight end. He has it at the 24-yard line for a first down. This is a very talented kid on the Mackey Award watch list this year as the best tight end in the nation candidate.
And a really nice throw to start the game for Mariota. That ball was thrown right on time, right on target.
Mariota on the keeper.
Lyrla with a good block on the corner. Nickel State, of course, was a mismatch, and look at the averages. Yards rushing, 22-6 at carry, 17-7 and 15-5. The receivers, including a 40-yard average per catch. In just ridiculous numbers, how much they relate to the rest of the season, we'll, of course, wait and see.
Yeah, I don't think Nickel State's back on the schedule for a while, so see how they do in their non-conference.
Too many men in the backfield. By the offense, 5 yards. Replay, second down.
That cost them 5 yards. We have a Pac-12 officiating crew today. Sean Hockley is the referee, the son of highly respected NFL official Ed Hockley. Second and 7 for the Ducks. DeAnthony Thomas cuts it off tackle. Gets a couple and then pushed back.
If there is an advantage to be had for Virginia today, it might be with their front four on the defensive line. Oregon is very good up front, but this is a strength up front. David Dean and Brent Urban in the middle, two very big defensive tackles, and Eli Harold, number 7, a defensive end who had 2 sacks last week. This is the position they need to be in, but the problem is it's 3rd and short for Oregon, so they can do anything in their offense right here.
Lyrla splits out. They'll even use him, number 15, as a running back. Pressure coming. Quarterback keeper. Plenty of room. Mariota. No one around him. And he outruns the entire Virginia defense for 71 yards. Well, he averaged 22.5 yards a carry last week. That's gone up. And they will force you to defend extra points. Oregon will do anything. They'll spread the field to see what the defense does. Now they see a defense they think will stop it, and they'll bring it back in for the place kicker.
I love that wrinkle on your special teams. It gives the other team so much to think about during the week and doesn't take long to do.
And they fake it after they go back in kick formation. And it's the holder, Dustin Haynes. Well, just when Virginia settles in and said, okay, they're going to kick it, they run a trip.
Yeah, and the trouble for Virginia head coach Mike London is on both of these, the touchdown and the 2-point conversion, there is nobody over the top on defense. There is no safety near Mariota, and on that 2-point conversion, there was no linebacker or safety to that side of the formation.
Marcus Mariota, and in Oregon terms, that drive took a long time. 1:51 to score. Normally, they're quicker than that. Mizell, 4 yards deep in the end zone for the Cavaliers. Mizell up to the 23, maybe the 24.
Watch the safety, the free safeties and the strong safety. That's Anthony Harris on the left and Brandon Phillips on the right. At the very end there, Anthony Harris is trying to get Brandon Phillips to back out and play the deep safety. Because it was a balanced spread formation, the safety Phillips, I think, was out of position, and it looked to me like Harris, who had a monster game last week, was trying to get him to back out and play the middle safety. And when Mariota breaks free, he has the top-end speed to run away from everybody when the safety's out of position.
A lot of pressure today on the Virginia offense. Can they sustain some drives? Can they keep the ball away from Oregon? Parks breaks it to the outside, and a flag goes down at the end of the play. That might have been a face mask as the All-American candidate Ekpre Olumu makes the tackle in the corner. Gain of 12. We await the penalty.
Yeah, I think they might have a holding out there on the edge.
Holding. Offense number 6. 10 yards. Replay. First down.
It's the wide receiver Darius Jennings, and that'll negate that play.
And watch as He holds Ifo Ekpre-Olumu, and you, as soon as the guy gets out of your frame, you just have to let go. You hold on every play. If you can get the jersey, you grab it, but Jennings just has to let go as Ekpre-Olumu bounces out.
Watford played for the first time in 2 years last week. He redshirted his previous season as they alternated between quarterbacks Michael Rocco and Perry Jones, both of whom are Michael Rocco and Phillip Sims, both of whom transferred, leaving the cupboard empty and giving Watford a chance to step up. Watford with his first throw goes out in the flat, complete to Tim Smith.
And Mike London, who had a huge staff change over after last year's disappointing four-win campaign, brought in all new coordinators, John Tenuta on defense, Steve Fairchild, the former head coach at Colorado State, comes in as the offensive coordinator. You mentioned the two quarterbacks leave, so all Fairchild has to do is take Watford, who'd been running the scout team last year, coming in February, and try to figure out during the spring what they have. And Fairchild was very honest yesterday, saying, I'm still not sure what we have on offense.
No, it's certainly a work in progress. Third down, about five. Parks, stutter step, can't get outside against the Oregon defense. And it's tackle Eric Armstead, the 296-pound sophomore who wouldn't let him turn the corner.
And the bad news for Virginia is you get into a place in a game like this where you're already down 8-0 and you're punting already, and it's not even DeAnthony Thomas who's back. It's Addison. And here's another guy who can score from anywhere. So if this were out near midfield, if I'm Virginia, I'm probably going for this.
Vozenelik to punt. Addison is deep, waits inside his 30. High short kick. This is going to be really good field position for the Ducks when we come back. They already lead by 7.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Buffalo Wild Wings, the official hangout for NCAA football. Ford, only Ford gives you EcoBoost fuel economy and a whole lot more. And Gatorade, Gatorade knows it all begins within. Win from within.
Lambeth Field here at Virginia, where they used to play football about 100 years ago, and they claim the first time the forward pass was ever thrown was at Lambeth Field, after they had a major discussion about the future of college football and how dangerous it was becoming, and they changed the rules. Things never seem to change, do they? 100 years later, we're doing the same thing.
Yes, the game is changing, and I think the spread offenses are going to change the game, not only from a schematic standpoint, but also for safety. I think it's could potentially.
Marshall with the carry. He's wrapped up in a hurry by Romero. Let's check in with Janine.
Well, Mike, if you're Virginia defensive coordinator John Tenuta, playing Oregon is your worst nightmare. He actually started prepping for this game back in the winter. He worked on it all spring and summer. He's talked to other coaches around the country. He told me if you watch Stanford and how they play Oregon, they play them pretty well. He said what he's learned is that certain fronts just will not work with these guys. He's had his defense go against two huddles all week in practice to simulate Oregon's tempo. And after that first series by Oregon, I can tell you, the Virginia linebackers and safeties were getting chewed out.
And Janine, he said they cannot afford to let the ball get outside the tackle box no matter what. Another running play, and Daquan Romero with another tackle. A surprisingly inefficient series for Oregon.
And for Oregon, everything was inside run looking type of plays, and we said if there is an advantage for Virginia, if there is an advantage for Virginia, it might be on that front, the front four, the first four defensive linemen. Now when they get the depth, that might flip, but on that drive, that front played very well for UVA.
First punt of the season for Alejandro Maldonado. You almost wonder if he can remember how he does it. They don't punt that often. Two of college football's most storied teams square off under the lights for the final time in Ann Arbor. This time, Brian Kelly's Fighting Irish look to flip the script and earn a huge road win, while Brady Hoke's number 17 Wolverines aim to cap off the rivalry with a big house victory celebration tonight at 8 Eastern on ESPN. I just hate to see these rivalry games disappear.
And a lot of this has to do with it ending, as Notre Dame is now a limited member of football in the ACC, so they've committed to so many games to teams within the ACC conference that Virginia is a part of, so Notre Dame having to back out of some of those bigger, almost non-conference games.
Parks on the toss. Breaks the tackle, picks up about three. Middle linebacker Rodney Hardrick made the tackle.
I know it's early in this game, but for Virginia, who struggled last week against a good BYU defense on offense, David Watford, the quarterback, talked about how nervous he was. If he settled down, they need a drive here. They need two, three, four first downs. They got a three and out on defense. This is where, if you're going to hang with Oregon, you have to be able to eat some clock and get some first down.
Last week, they managed only 223 yards in total offense and still won. And that pass incomplete. Crowd wanted a flag. There is none.
Yeah, they missed it. That Brian Jackson.
It was intended for Jennings. And Brian Jackson, number 12, the safety, made contact.
And it sure looked to me like that contact knocked. The question is the ball catchable? And it looked in the place where Jennings may have been able to fall for it. That was a missed call by this Pac-12 crew. That looked like pass interference to me. And now for Virginia, unfortunately, here you are, third and long, deep in your own territory.
Would have been a huge call for them. They'll go with the two tight end formation on third and seven. Pressure coming, and they'll blow it dead. Delay of game.
Delay by the offense. 5 yards. Third down.
Those are the mistakes, the mental mistakes they can't make.
They drive you crazy. And Mike London, last year there were some hiccups in game management against Virginia Tech. The quarterback controversy that looked like we did the game against Penn State, where all of a sudden Phillip Sims was coming in. So there have been some questions around here. That's why they went and got a very veteran staff when they changed over. But this is a big penalty early.
Paid a lot of money for those new coaches. Complete to the tight end up to about the 13-yard line. Jake McGee makes the grab. The former quarterback who had to put on a lot of weight to play the tight end position, Derek Malone, made the tackle. A very safe call, a little swing in effect.
The problem is that 5-yard penalty puts you in a place where they had a route beyond the sticks, but with a young quarterback, he's going to get nervous. Down in his own territory, he's going to come down to the guy running underneath, and you're not going to pick up the first. And here you are punting again.
Rosenelik, who had a 21-yard punt, has that one blocked. And it goes out of bounds at the 14-yard line. They put pressure on him this time, and Josh Huff came in and got a hand on it, a net zero, and a huge special teams play for Oregon.
A lot of times you see the best guys to block punts are actually wide receivers. The bottom of your screen, in the middle, Huff did a wonderful job. That took entirely too long to get that punt off.
Sure
Huff
did.
Was able from the middle to actually run around the wedge and get the block. That punt should have gotten off about a half second before that.
If he has to take a route that's that long, he should never get to the
punt. It looked to me, I thought he was lining up to the outside, but he started in the middle and went around. That just took forever.
Mariotta in the gun. And again, they'll test the middle. This time with DeAnthony Thomas.
And if you look at this Oregon offense, I think most people that know the program think the loss of Kenyon Barner to graduation was a big deal. DeAnthony Thomas is just not a between the tackles runner. He's more in space. He likes the position more where he can slash and move around. Good job by the officials letting the defense make some substitutions because the offense did.
But Mariota has handed it off to him. Has had four straight running plays up the middle, and they have given them nothing.
Five.
And somebody is either hurt or cramping up, and they'll stop play. While we have the opportunity, let's take a look at today's Impact matchup brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
Well, one of the real strengths of this Oregon team is we've already seen Josh Huff in the special teams, but you've mentioned Colt Lyrla, who's a really talented big athlete. Demetrius Nicholson, the best cover corner for Virginia. We just saw Anthony Harris, the strong safety who played great against BYU, trying to make an adjustment to help the middle of the field. But this, with the defensive front for Virginia and that secondary, that's their best shot.
Mariota has Thomas with him in the backfield. Mariota over the middle, a wide open receiver to the goal line and marked down, maybe a foot away, Darryl Hawkins, who couldn't have been any more uncovered in the middle of that defense.
Well, Virginia, as Oregon's now going very fast, but Virginia having a real hard time just lining up.
And they caught Virginia with an extra man on the field.
Before the snap and before the foul for the defense having 12 men, the previous play is under further review. The ruling on the field is that the runner was stopped short of the goal line.
Actually, a break for the Virginia Cavaliers. One, it would have been a penalty. Two, it would have been a touchdown. Watch Hawkins.
Again, it's that middle of the field. I think he scored.
Need to see another angle. That's tough.
But watch as he goes down. Does his elbow hit before the ball? Yeah, well, from that angle, he wouldn't be able to overturn it because the elbow did hit. And it's not clear whether the ball for Hawkins crosses the line from that angle. Yeah, I think he's right on it. He's right on it, but because there isn't right down the line, there's just no way that they're going to be able to overturn this.
You know, we talked to Mike London yesterday about the one area of this game. Obviously, he is overmatched in personnel with the number two team in the country. The one area he might be able to,
the play stands as called. First down, Oregon.
Might be able to make inroads is on special teams, but not negatively.
Yeah, they've two punts, total of 21 yards in punts. And this was a tough, special teams were tough on Virginia last year. He went out and hired Larry Lewis, who was at Nevada as a special teams coordinator, but still have to execute.
Thomas up the middle, bumps a defender, and then walks in. 14-0 Oregon at the 7:15 mark. Now what will they do for the PAT this time?
And the hard part, if for Virginia, you start to get shell-shocked with this much speed. When a quarterback, as now Oregon spreads it out on the PAT, but when a quarterback can outrun your secondary, because Mariota has incredible top-end speed on that first drive, and then you have the bad punt. You get a little shell-shocked with these guys that can get ugly early.
Wogan is in as the kicker, as they will alternate kickers. And it was partially blocked, and it's no good. Brent Urban got penetration. The big defensive tackle, so Virginia makes a play on teams. Not much resistance on the touchdown run. Mizell and Shepard are deep for Virginia. Wogan to kick it away for Oregon. They're already up 14-0, and a squibber that gets by Mizell. He has to pick it up inside the 10 and swarmed over short of that yard mark. Our first chance of the day to check in with the studio. Here's Robert Flores. Robert.
Hey, Mike, Ohio State is up 14-0 on San Diego State. Dontre Wilson, the freshman, scores. Now, before this play, Braxton Miller left the game after the touchdown, carted into the locker room with an apparent knee injury. Buckeyes up 14-0. We'll continue to update Braxton Miller as soon as we have further information.
Well, that would be such a shame for them. I mean, not only is he their obvious leader of the offense, but he has come such a long way from when we saw him start his career there. Little toss out in the flat. Khalid Shepard will pick up a first down as he gets it up across the 20.
now, if the one thing that Mike London wanted when he went to look for an offensive coordinator after Bill Lazor left, coincidentally, to go work for Chip Kelly for the Eagles, who'll get his start as an NFL coach tomorrow against the Redskins. But when Mike London went looking for an offensive coordinator, he wanted a guy with NFL experience, which he got. Fairchild was the offensive coordinator for St. Louis back in the early 2000s, but also a power run game, and I think they can get that going.
Taequann Mizell, one of their big-time recruits, picks up 8 yards. His nickname is Smoke. He was their first five-star recruit in 8 years. Mitchell and Hart combined on the tackle.
And unfortunately for Virginia, Mizell comes off looking like he's limping. That's a guy that they don't have a lot of explosive players. That'd be a big loss.
Shepard powers his way to a first down, an important first down for Virginia. Armstead makes the tackle, but not until he's out to the 34.
And Virginia fans, of course, they had Perry Jones the last couple of years, who's a good explosive player. Park's a good inside runner, but not quite as explosive as Jones. So if Taequann Mizell is down, now you lose what little depth you were already trying to build with a little more explosive player in the backfield.
In his debut against BYU, he only had 16 yards on 7 carries, so they handled him pretty well. Tight end Zachary Swanson, makes the catch across the 40. The middle linebacker Hardrick again.
And Watford looks completely different at the beginning of this game than he did against BYU. Admitted that he was very nervous. He looks pretty good right now.
Totally calm and in control. This to Darius Jennings. A little flanker screen, and they can't get anything out of that one.
And now, this is the part of the field where I know it's third and short, but if you're Virginia, I think you've got to start thinking about four down territory. Whenever you get out towards the middle of the field, I don't know why you would punt to Oregon. So I know this sounds crazy on third and two, but if I'm Virginia, I'm thinking, well, maybe this is four down. So maybe this is a place where you try a play action or a run action and see if you can't sneak one long.
Of course, you're basing that on the thought that Oregon's going to score 50, 60 points, which is not a bad assumption. Watford under pressure, tipped and intercepted, picked up by Terrence Mitchell. Mitchell's got a couple of blockers, now reverses his field and has more. Look at this run by Mitchell, then he fumbled, but I think he was down. A return of 17 yards for the Thorpe Award candidate who was suspended a week ago for a helmet-to-helmet hit.
And because that suspension was in the first half, they got Mitchell back for this week. The ball goes a lot of white jerseys over there. They read the rollout perfectly. The throw not great, but it went off the hands of Dominique Terrell. And then a nice return by Mitchell.
Would have been a great catch. Instead, it turns into an interception. Thomas, look at that quickness. Good grief. Thomas. Jake Fisher threw him a block at the corner. At least two guys had an angle. Two guys had to be able to get him, and neither one of them even touched him.
Jake Fisher completely got the edge. That was exactly what John Tenuta said couldn't happen to this Virginia defense. And the speed, boy, how did he stay in? Sure looked like he did. They're not reviewing it, but that speed, the speed of the quarterback of Oregon, and now the speed of DeAnthony Thomas.
Ruling on the field is a touchdown. The previous play is under further review.
This year, if there is a scoring play, it must be reviewed, and the officials must wait for it before the point after.
Well, but if you're Virginia, and in the first drive you see Marcus Mariota, Mariota isn't the quickest guy in the world, but his top-end speed is really good. And then you've got this guy who takes a toss sweep and outruns everybody, including your safety, Brandon Phelps. The right foot is in. The left foot is in. Okay, so here's an interesting rule. The ball actually goes outside
the
pylon.
Stands as called.
Yep.
It is a touchdown.
The ball went outside the pylon in college football to get what's called goal line extended, meaning the goal line goes out of bounds. The offensive player has to touch the pylon or in the end zone, which DeAnthony Thomas did, so therefore it's a touchdown.
The point after by Maldonado is good, and Oregon is just destroying the Cavaliers. They're up 21-0. Thomas simply outran perfect angles by two defenders to get that score. They are celebrating here in the first quarter on the Oregon sideline. And this is going to be gut check time for Virginia. You still have 4:28 left in the first quarter. You're already down 3 scores. You've had a punt block and a pass intercepted. Just about everything that can go wrong has gone wrong. They have to regroup. Mizell and Shepherd are deep. Better kick this time. Mizell 4 yards deep, and Shepherd says, let's take it here and go out to the 25. In 2 days, Monday Night Football returns to ESPN with a pair of games. First at 6:55, the Eagles take on the Redskins. Then at 10:15, the Texans against the Chargers. Coverage starts with Monday Night Countdown at 5 and a Monday Night Football doubleheader. 6:55 and 10:15 on ESPN, as well as live on Watch ESPN. Welcome. So many people up around the D.C. area. So excited to have RG3 back.
And I think the people in Philadelphia will be pretty happy with their coach. I think Chip Kelly's one of the few guys who will make this transition well.
Out of the eye this time, Parks lowers his shoulder, gets a yard, maybe a yard and a half. Will his offense work in the NFL, Ed Cunningham?
Yeah, I think it will. I think Chip is one of those guys who, it's not really the system. He's built the system because that's what he knows. He's a guy who really gets the game. The players respond to him very well. I made a comment during the offseason. I thought Oregon would take a step back because Chip Kelly, to me, is just one of those people that's special as a coach. Now, being around the program, seeing how steady it is under the hand of Mark Helfrich, I'm not sure how much of a step it's actually going to take back now that I've been around them this week, but that's a good coach.
Three-man rush. Watford still under pressure. He'll try to carry it. Dives forward near the 30. It'll be third and call it 6. The thing they have done in Oregon going back many, many years, starting with Rich Brooks, they have filled those vacancies internally. They have brought guys up. The culture remains the same. They've done a marvelous job.
A lot of people don't realize that the Oregon system started being built in 1977 by Rich Brooks. And if you don't know who Rich Brooks is, look it up. He was a wonderful coach at Oregon, the last guy who won regularly at Kentucky. The guy could really coach.
Third and 5, four-man rush, low pass, completed right at the sticks to McGee, where they're going to mark it. It looks like he's got it by about a foot.
And McGee, a guy for Virginia that they need to get going. He missed a lot of spring. You can see his left shoulder is taped. He had an injury in camp. He missed spring with a class obligation. So just now getting to know this offense, a former high school quarterback, not very physical at the tight end, but he had 2 game-winning catches last year, and someone who really understands space and has great hands.
Pretty good conversion for a guy who came as a quarterback. Parks, they try a little misdirection look. And Parks will get about 5 to the 40.
And already Virginia looks like they have so much more offense than they did last week against BYU. Steve Fairchild, when we were talking to him getting ready for this game, he got here in February. Bill Lazor left a little bit late. They brought him in. He said, in the first 10 practices, all we could do was install our power running game. The next 5 practices, I had to figure out what I had.
Yeah.
They didn't know who their starting quarterback was. So last week was very vanilla. They look like they've added some nice wrinkles.
It was not an easy way to start for him. Short pass again, this time to Parks. And Parks will have enough for a first down up near midfield. Troy Hill made the tackle. I really liked Lazor as an offensive coordinator last year.
Guy who had NFL experience, went back to the NFL. But Watford looks so much better than he did. Take nothing away from Virginia. They beat BYU, who, when the season's over, is going to have 9 or 10 wins, just like they always do. That's a good team. But Watford looked late on his reads. He looked uncomfortable. Looks quite different today.
Gamble and Smith are the wide receivers. Watford, here comes a blitz. He'll throw underneath again his tight end, Jake McGee. And obviously, McGee is going to be his relief valve. That's his third catch. Dargan, the free safety, made the tackle, as Oregon has some backup players in there right now.
And nice job by Dargan going low as the player is crossing the field. If you go high on that, that's one of the places where you can be called for targeting. Remember, Terrence Mitchell got called for targeting on a quarterback that was sliding. He went down late, had the contact that was the target, and that was a nice job by Dargan going low.
Shepard. Shepard, great cut to the 20. He's got a chance. Touchdown, Derek Shepard. 45 yards. Boy, did they need that. That one couldn't have come at a better time. Cavaliers are in danger of getting blown out of their own stadium. Ian Fry for the point after. And Virginia, in front of a big crowd, comes back with only 45 seconds to go on the first quarter clock. That was a pretty impressive drive, went 75 yards in seven plays, and Shepard capped it with that beautiful run.
Watford doing such a better job getting the ball around in the passing game, and now you set up your power run game, and right there, Dargan playing very deep because they're starting to throw a little bit, but Dargan does not break down. Shepard makes a great cut back across. We saw Dargan do the nice job earlier on the tackle going low. That time overruns the play, and I think you're right, Mike. If they don't score and have a positive drive there, this could be 100-0. Now, if you're Virginia, this sounds crazy. Why not try an onside kick here? Get a little momentum. Who cares if you give the ball to Oregon on the 50 or the 20? They're just as dangerous from both parts of the field, so why not try to take advantage and get a little onside kick here?
Thomas and Love are deep.
And the other part, too, an onside kick doesn't get caught by number six, DeAnthony Thomas. The middle of the field is open for Ian Fry. You can do that little drag kick. I just feel like
it would be a courageous call, wouldn't it?
You said at the beginning, this is like basketball on grass. Well, sometimes you have to force some turnovers in basketball because it becomes a possession game.
This would be a long three-pointer is what this would be if they try that. They'll kick it away. Thomas at the goal line. Whoa! Depleted at the 22. He was blown up by Kelvin Rainey.
I'm not sure if that wasn't DeForest Buckner, the defensive tackle, who actually gets the bigger of the two hits. Because Buckner looks a little slow to get up.
Yeah, Buckner. It was Rainey being blocked by Buckner.
Rainey did a nice job of squeezing it, but Buckner took a hit. He came off. This is the guy who adds depth to their defensive line. Let's hope he gets looked at, because he looked a little woozy after that hit.
Oregon so far in this quarter, 9 carries for 123 yards. Yikes. It's almost 15 yards a touch. They'll try the middle of that line again with Marshall, and Marshall's pushed back. There's the ball on the ground. Is it a fumble? No, they're going to say it's second down.
And Oregon going very fast because they don't want it reviewed. Very smart.
And the challenge flag came out.
No, that was Mariota.
It's a penalty flag.
Mariota took he had a yellow towel in his waistband, and right before the snap, he yanked it and threw it, so it looked like a flag. But I, you know, when you have a fumble like that, I think the officials upstairs should have stopped that. If it's close, and Oregon very obviously said, let's just run it fast, I think they should stop that upstairs just so they could get a quick look to see if that was a turnover.
This will be third and 10. Haven't even had a chance to show you the replay of that because of this hurry-up offense, but we will. Mariota forced out of the pocket, throws on the run, and that's out of bounds. Good catch by Thomas, but he was clearly out of bounds when he came down. You can be forced out of bounds.
Great job by John Tenuta. Tenuta, a guy who a lot of people say, oh, he blitzes on every down. He's one of those, but he's not. They play a lot of coverage. He mixed things up. That time, though, he brought the outside linebacker, Daquan Romero, and it made Mariota come off of his read and throw short.
John Tenuta knows every blitz there is, and then probably a couple nobody else has ever seen. Again, high, short kick, and there was contact just as the ball got there, and there is no flag.
That's a missed call.
No flag.
Yeah, there's a new rule in college football this year that for the width of the shoulders of the returner and 1 yard in front, you can't be there. But Derek Malone looks clearly to me like he is within 1 yard before the ball is caught. Yeah, they need to throw a flag for kick catch interference.
He was within 1 inch.
Yeah. That's a missed call. It's close. That's closing, but again, it's a safety thing, but luckily all everyone's okay.
It's a safety thing, so if it's questionable, you've got to make that call, don't you?
Yeah, I think you do.
Back to the ground for Virginia, and they will run out the clock in the first quarter. 28 points on the board in the first 15 minutes of football from Charlottesville. And it's 21-7, Oregon. Because of the pace of this game, it's 21-7 as we start the second quarter. This is the first chance we've had to show you what we thought was a fumble, and surely it was. And then recovered. Oregon goes so fast, they put everybody in a real bind, including the replay booth. Watford, oh, good throw that time. He stepped and put some body into that. Zachary Swanson on a bullet.
And back to that fumble, and I mentioned then, if it's close, you have to stop play. With as fast as they're going, that was obviously a fumble by Byron Marshall. Now, Virginia got the ball back, but it was on the negative side of the field. Oregon got the ball back, but I'm saying Oregon then punted
right,
so that Virginia gets the ball back. And now you're sitting here saying, well, wait a minute, Virginia down two scores would have had the ball in the red zone had you given them that fumble.
Taquan Mizell is in the game. They look his way, throw back the other way to their favorite receiver, Darius Jennings, trying to get Mizell to draw some of the defense to the near side and then throw back, but Oregon defensed it perfectly.
And Oregon obviously recovers the fumble, but I still think you should review it now. But understand this, if the replay officials saw that it was reviewed, they don't necessarily have to stop the game. But I would just want to make sure that Oregon did recover it and it wasn't a fumble. I think they should have stopped it.
It's a fine line there. You don't want to stop the game unnecessarily, but you want to make sure the call is right. Oregon had a player line up off sides and barely got back. And here's McGee fighting for extra yardage down near the 35. Four catches for Jake McGee, the junior tight end from Richmond, Virginia.
And so far, Watford just looks like a different quarterback than he did last week. That time comes back down to the tight end. He's hit the tight end five times so far early in this game. And McGee, a guy who's starting to look like he's got a feel for this offense, despite that injury he suffered during camp.
Very calm. You got to like his demeanor in the pocket. Let's see if Oregon tries to dial up some pressure. Now they'll come with four. Watford floats this to the near side, a catchable ball for Jennings, and it went through his hands. Troy Hill was there defensively, but it looked like Jennings should have had that one.
A little bit of a late throw. That was what I noticed against BYU, is Watford sometimes will lock in and takes the ball a little while to get out of his hand. Just the ball floats just a little bit, takes a while. Good coverage by Hill, but now you have to go for this if you're Virginia, of course. I think this has to be some, you know, the quarterback can really run here. I would want him away from the middle of the pocket.
Try to spread the field. Got McGee to this side. It's a flanker screen and nothing doing. They tried to throw the flanker screen to Terrell and have McGee blocking downfield. He got his block, but there was an expert defender, Derek Malone, there, and they'll turn the ball over on downs. Good defense by Oregon.
Yeah, and Virginia, the way they run this screen is the receiver actually goes backwards and doesn't work towards the quarterback. Dominic Terrell backs up. I've always felt like with a wide receiver screen, the receiver needs to be working back towards the quarterback, so when he catches it, he's on the run. If he's standing there and the defense is coming towards him and fighting off blocks, I just think it takes too long to get going. I think you have to run that receiver back towards the quarterback.
Marshall at tailback. He'll get the carry. No! Mariota with a fake, and he's gone again. Beautiful play fake by the sophomore from Honolulu.
Whoa. What a great job by the tight end, Colt Lyerla. He just absolutely went up on the safety, Harris, and swallowed him up in the block.
Want to throw a little screen, and great athleticism by Brent Urban. 6'7", 295, and able to run out in the flat and knock it down.
Watch the tight end here, Lyerla, as he releases, and it looks like a pass to Harris, and then just has no chance to get off the block of the 6'5", 250-pound tight end.
They are so high on Lyerla. He is a do-everything, freakish kind of athlete. And right on cue, he drops the pass over the middle. Let's check in with Janine.
Well, guys, I can tell you, understandably, the Virginia defensive coaches are very, very animated in this game, trying to keep their guys in the thick of this. The defensive line coach, Vincent Brown, is telling them they can't block you up front. Everything's going to the edges, while secondary coach Anthony Poindexter keeps reminding his DBs, guys, we showed you these plays over and over and over. Where is your head?
Mariota being chased. They get to him just as he throws and completes it to the 35-yard line to Darryl Hawkins. What a great throw and a nice catch.
And here goes Oregon very fast, fourth and short. I would think maybe an option to the left, going very fast.
Flanker screen. How's that for a fourth and short call? Did he get to the line of scrimmage? Keenan Lowe made the catch, but Demetrius Nicholson came up and hit him.
What an excellent tackle by Nicholson. Watch the form by number one. He fights through the block, not much of a block by Josh Huff. Huff missed him, and Nicholson just comes up and does an excellent job of form tackling Lowe. Beat the block, make the tackle. Nice job.
Above anything else against an offense.
The turnover on downs, it's first and 10 for Virginia. After the play was over, unsportsmanlike conduct by number 75, Oregon, rope flag, 15 yards, first down.
That's Jake Fisher, the offensive tackle, and that's huge because it takes him up near midfield. But what I was going to say, the one thing that you have to do against the spread, you have to be able to tackle in space, and that was a great tackle.
Nicholson, a young guy who's been starting since the first day he got here. He's a junior. This secondary for Virginia, very experienced. Nicholson, their best cover corner, that time defeated the block, and then the help by a veteran offensive tackle in Fisher to give an extra 15 yards to the Cavaliers.
Shepherd the tailback on this series. Nowhere to go on the toss. Swallowed up. He'll lose a yard. Ricky Haemuli.
The one thing we really haven't seen from Virginia, and we expect them to start working in more and more, is the run action pass, because they do want to run a power run game. They have a lot of tight ends and fullbacks that come and move around the line of scrimmage. But as they get a little run game going, don't be surprised if Fairchild starts putting the ball in the stomach of the running back and letting Watford take some throws down the field.
Watford told us he thought he'd have a chance to run a little more, maybe even an option look or two. Straight ahead. Gee, not much there. Haemuli again, the tackle on Shepherd.
You know, I know that Virginia wants to have a power run game. I get that. That's what they're trying to build. But seems to me when they're in rhythm, it's screens, it's letting Watford move around, it's letting him throw it a little bit. I'm not saying abandon.
Release
I'm not saying abandon it, but you get the ball back, and all of a sudden you're at third and 10 because you get a little conservative with your first two calls.
Now they take both tight ends out of the game, spread the field. Gamble is in along with Terrell and Tim Smith. Terrell, number two, is in the slot near side. Watford chased. Can't find anybody. Now throws the sideline and dropped. Kevin Parks would have been very, very close to a first down. Bobbled the ball, couldn't hold it.
Parks, the ball, he turned one way and the ball came back the other way. If this ball is thrown back to the inside, Parks easily picks up the first down. Just a little, watch how Parks goes to release. Very smart, but the ball thrown to the outside, he turned to the inside. And now Virginia, I think you're at that point. I know it's fourth and 10, but I think you do have to punt it, but you really have to think about it against Oregon.
They're going
to
be old school on you. Yeah. Braylon Addison, as that one hangs high but goes into the end zone. 53-yard kick. That time, 10:42 to go in the half. Oregon jumped out to a 21-0 lead. The Cavaliers have cut it to a 14-point spread. And now Oregon will start from its own 20-yard line. DeAnthony Thomas, the running back. Mariota to throw, and incomplete right through the hands of Lyerlin.
Well, and that's one thing the coaches talk about is focus, off-the-field type of stuff. There's no doubt that this young man is incredibly competitive on the field, but you get focus in. That's two drops in a row for number 15. They won't come off him because he is a really special player, but he's got to dial it in a bit.
That one had some heat on it, though.
Yeah, it did.
Here comes Thomas. Look at that burst. Holy cow. Anthony Harris, who was the Walter Camp Foundation National Defensive Player of the Week a week ago when he blocked a punt and had an interception against BYU, both of which led to touchdowns, had to make the tackle way downfield on that one. Fake to Thomas, then they'll swing it to him. Thomas across midfield, down near the 30. Daquan Romero had a shot at him to stop him for a short gain. Instead, it turns into 28 yards.
That looked to me like Daquan Romero was afraid to go finish the tackle. He got there, slowed down, went to stop because of the movement of Anthony. DeAnthony Thomas, who got stiff on.
Flanker screen, Braylon Addison, touchdown. Hamani Stevens got out there and threw him a nice block. And Braylon Addison, who they think can be a playmaker for 3 years to come, he's only a sophomore, gets the fourth touchdown for the Ducks today. If you're a defensive player, this has just got to be a blinding rhythm.
Well, when they run a system like this and spread you out and then have the athletes like that, there just comes a point where how do you play defense? The open of the show, we showed you Marcus Mariota. We showed you DeAnthony Thomas. We said, yeah, but they've got this new guy, number 11, Braylon Addison. You can see he's pretty good in space as well. Yeah, that's my kind of night.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by the all-new 2014 Chevy Silverado. The Venture Card from Capital One. Earn double miles you could actually use. And the Home Depot. More saving, more doing. That's the power of the Home Depot.
These are the Hooligans, a breakdance club here at UVA. Let's just hope there is no disco club.
Be a good touchdown dance.
You do it first. Khalid Shepard on the return for the Cavaliers. And let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. Oregon's offense as good as advertised. They're up 28-7. Mariota already has 196 total yards in offense. Thomas, 64 carries, two TDs. Shepard had a 45-yard touchdown run. Stars galore. Oregon second in the polls this week. Taquan Mizell will be the tailback for the Cavaliers. He goes out and makes the catch over the middle and then double team and taken down at the 27-yard line.
I'm sure Cavs fans happy to see Mizell back in the game. He looked like he maybe had hurt himself earlier. Top recruit, somebody they expect. True freshman, so it takes a little while, especially as a running back in this offense. They have a lot to do in the blocking, pass blocking, blitz pickup, so it takes a little while to get going.
He's from Virginia Beach, that 757 area code that they recruit so heavily. And trying to keep so many of those talented kids. That's Norfolk, Virginia Beach, Hampton, Chesapeake, that area. And there is a world of talent there.
And that's an area that Frank Beamer and his staff at Virginia Tech, right when they got there in the mid-80s, just started making inroads to that 757 area code. Of course, got Michael Vick to come to Virginia Tech. And so Virginia with a chance with a little bit of rust on the Hokies the last couple of years, maybe to step it up a bit over in that side of the state.
Third and five. Terrell goes in motion. Watford throws for Terrell. He's got it out at the 32-yard line. It's going to be shy of a first down.
I think you got it.
Ekpre Olamu made the tackle. And I think I'm starting to go over to your philosophy.
Yeah.
You're not going to stop Oregon. You're going to have to score some points.
Well, there comes a point where you say, okay, where would you rather defend Oregon? And they pick up the first, so. And Mark Helfrich not happy with that spot. I think he thought that that was short.
Sure looked like
it. Yeah, it sure did. But we'll get back to this idea of not punting throughout the broadcast, because I think if you're playing Oregon and you're under man, I think you have to start thinking about that.
Eight men drop. They throw again to the tight end underneath. Jake McGee makes the tackle. Five catches for the junior.
If you're Mike London and you're looking at this game and you think, okay, how do we win? The idea of field position and time of possession and those things should not even factor in to your decision tree. I know it's preposterous to say never punt, but there are people who do it. There are studies that say you win more often if you don't. But against a team like Oregon, I would rather defend a short field. I'd rather defend them from the 10-yard line in than the other side 20.
Those mathematicians that come up with those theories, these are not guys who are under contract to universities, are they?
Well, there's a lot of economists, actually, college professors, that talk about the idea of not punting on fourth down, that if you laid it out, it actually looks like it'd go for you. But I think the way the game is changing, I think when you're playing a team like Oregon that can score this many points this fast, what does it matter what, if you're going to defend them, I don't think 15 yards or 70 yards matters.
Another big play for Virginia, third and five. Blitz coming. Watford hangs in the pocket and floats it up and overthrows his intended receiver, Darius Jennings.
Well, and that Virginia went for it that time. They tried a little bit of action, and then they used Jennings on a double move with a go route. Unfortunately, the pocket started to break down, and Watford and Jennings just completely, there was, the timing was just not there on that pattern.
So Virginia will kick it away. Vozenelik to kick to Braylon Addison, who waits at his 20. Good kick this time. A boomer toward the sideline. Addison backpedals, breaks a tackle, and takes it out across the 30. An 18-yard return after a 49-yard punt until the tackle by Reho Walker.
Of course, we all know Marcus Mariota, the quarterback, can throw it. But the hard part is when you come to play Oregon, you realize, oh, wait a minute, he's pretty fast as well. And I think we all know the Anthony Thomas is fast, but on that run, there were two safeties for Virginia who looked like they had angles, and number six outran them both.
Byron Marshall will be the tailback on this series and gets about 3 yards up the middle to his own 34. Jake Snyder, the defensive end who led all down linemen in tackles a year ago for the Cavaliers. Pretty good numbers in the first half. 34 yards a run for Mariota. He averaged 22.6 a week ago. Flag is down. How did he get out of there? He'll only gain a couple as Snyder made the tackle, but it looked like he would be sacked. There are two flags on the play. And Mariota protesting.
I think they got illegal hands to the face.
Personal foul. Illegal hands to the face by the offense number 71. 15 yards. Replay. Second down.
Everett Benyard the third, the guard. But the only way to slow him down is walk off a penalty against him.
Yeah, Ben Yardick, who's in the mix in that guard rotation for the Ducks, clearly has a hold of the face mask of David Dean.
Second and 22. And they'll only gain a couple before David Dean makes the tackle.
David Dean's really good in the middle for Virginia. This is a young man, just a sophomore, looking at him on film. He plays so low to the ground. He has great power. I think this guy is going to be a real special player for Virginia. Right now, he's pushing some white shirts backwards in the run game.
Third and 19. Mariota with the screen and diagnosed perfectly. Byron Marshall will be tackled for a loss. Daquan Romero, who had 12 tackles a week ago, has been very active this afternoon.
And Romero, remember, was the guy who looked like he slowed down for that long DeAnthony Thomas run, this time just completely in the perfect position for the dump off, and was smart enough to finish the tackle because Byron Marshall didn't look like he was down on that first one, and give Romero a big credit for hanging on and finishing that tackle.
Maldonado to punt to Dominique Terrell. Booms it. Terrell back at the 28. Gets a running start and is hit out of bounds. No, is there a flag? There's a flag across the way, 10-yard return after a 50-yard punt. But that was right in front of the Virginia bench.
And that was Tony Washington. Because he ducked his head.
After the play was over, personal foul, late hit by Oregon number 39. 15 yards
was in the field of the play.
First down.
Yeah, they're actually calling Drew Howe, who is the long snapper, for a late hit, not Washington. So that was in the field of play, not at the out of bounds.
That's Drew Howell, the long snapper, who got that last penalty. It was a hit in bounds, not the one we had referred to earlier, but it was after the whistle and correctly called by this crew. Watford throws, nearly picked. Take a look. And Howell will peel back a little bit. He's 38 or 39. And there's that hit.
Good call.
And definitely was after the play.
And now it's up to Virginia with good field position. And another three and out for Oregon. Oregon on seven drives. They either score a touchdown or it's three and out. And see if Virginia can take advantage.
Parks, the tailback. Nothing. Got back to the line of scrimmage. Robert Flores in the studio with an update. Robert.
Hey, Mike, right now on ESPN, Georgia's on top of South Carolina 7-3. Aaron Murray, who's looking for a bounce-back game after the loss to Clemson, finds Arthur Lynch. And right now, Bulldogs leading South Carolina 7-3 on ESPN first quarter. Speaking of not punting, guys, when I play Madden, I don't punt either.
I'm telling you, there's going to come a point where you have to give up the punting game.
Watford, third and long. He's going to take off. Got the first down. Fosico Lacumbo, who has already been drafted by the Canadian Football League, he's a senior at Oregon, made that stop.
And this is one thing that Watford, when we were talking to him yesterday, said he wanted to do a quicker read of when to pull it down and run. That time, immediately, as soon as he saw the alley, he took off. That was a good decision. And the guy can run. So Fairchild, the offensive staff, is pushing him. It's not a bad option.
Bradley overthrown for the end zone, incomplete in the hands. Now they're going to say a personal foul
personal
on the
foul.
Play.
Roughing the quarterback by the defense number 90. 15 yards, automatic, first down.
Pass could have been easily intercepted, but as it turns out, Haemuli roughed the passer. Hit him across the face. Not much contact, but
yeah,
that's the rule says.
Well, he hit him, it looked to me like across the chest. I think it was that right arm coming down. If he wouldn't have done that, I don't think they call it, but boy, that's awfully close. I'm not sure you throw that one.
Parks got a couple, could not get away from Ekpre Olamu.
You know what?
The best corner in the country.
One of the things for Virginia, they decided they want to build a pro power run game. One of the problems with that is it brings a lot of bodies around the line of scrimmage. You know, it's a little bit like we're watching the Flintstones play the Jetsons, where Virginia plays in a way that's more old school, get bodies around. The problem is then there's a lot more white jerseys to block when you pack everybody in.
Watford, good throw out in the flat to Swanson. Swanson down to about the 13-yard line. Avery Patterson with the tackle, three catches for Swanson.
Watford just looks like a different guy today than he did against BYU. I know I've said that repeatedly, but when I watched that first half and it was pouring rain, they had a two-hour lightning delay in that game. Watford played a little better in the sec when they came back after the rain delay. He said he calmed down, but here's a position. There's no way you can think field goal if you're Virginia. So you've got him packed in. I would love to see a run action pass and get one of these tight ends free.
Khalid Shepard in at the tailback spot. Watford in trouble. Down he goes at the 20.
And now the
Tony
problem.
Washington and Kalei Kipi got in on the stop.
And now the problem.
Timeout, Oregon.
Oregon uses a timeout with 2:04. I think that's to save time for their offense, no matter what happens in this situation. Now, if I was going to ask you, have you changed your mind now on a field goal, or do you go with it fourth and long?
The problem is 28-10. Oregon's going to get the ball back. The way they've looked, I just don't think three gets you anywhere. I still think you have to go for it.
So the answer is no.
Well, they're going to kick. Virginia's going to kick the field goal. And this is a conversation I think that, you know, you heard me have it twice this week with John Tenuta, the defensive coordinator from Virginia, and Nick Alioti, the defensive coordinator from Oregon. They think I'm crazy, but there just has to start to come a time where you throw some of the old thinking out.
Ian Fry will try from 37. His one field goal this year, his one for one, was from 53. And Fry is true again, and the Cavaliers cut the lead to 28-10. And now for today's Aflac trivia question, Marcus Mariota's 3,429 total yards in 2012 ranks second in Oregon single season history. Who is first? And in our production meeting last night, Ed Cunningham was all over it.
So I can't play along.
No, you can't. You got to wait.
And now
the answer may surprise a lot of people.
Now for Oregon, 2 minutes and 4 seconds. It might be 10 minutes for this offense. With two timeouts.
Nothing.
Yeah, two timeouts. They get into a rhythm. For Virginia, I think you have to start thinking about taking some chances. Some throws that are out in the flat, run underneath them. Keep working to try to strip that ball out.
Time of possession, you can see, means nothing in a game against Oregon. Squib kick. All the way through to Lowe, and Lowe fires out to the 42. Let's go to Janine.
Well, guys, one thing the Oregon coaches have tried to work on with quarterback Marcus Mariota in the offseason is helping him to become more of a leader because he is such a shy kid. I've been watching him on the sideline here. He spends 90% of his time by himself. He told us it hasn't been easy for him. He's had to keep reminding himself to be more assertive, to be more vocal, to be that guy, as he said. But he said it's still an ongoing process. His teammates are trying to help him, but you can see Mariota still, his shyness has taken over.
All right, Janine Thomas on a sweep. He keeps making plays. I don't know how much more important he can be if he keeps making 71-yard runs, flags down everywhere.
Virginia getting a little frustrated.
And Thomas wolfing the Snyder.
And at the very end there, they get number 90, Jake Snyder. He puts his hand on the face of D'Anthony Thomas and pushes him away. You don't need to help these guys, that's for sure.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness by Virginia number 90. Following that, unsportsmanlike conduct by Oregon number 6, taunting. Both fouls will be enforced. It will be first and 10 for Oregon.
And you could see Thomas Wolfen when he left. I think that's an excellent call. Both guys did something wrong.
Good job by this officiating crew. A game like this, who knows what the second half is going to bring, but you have to nip this stuff in the bud. And, you know, that's just a little uncalled for by Snyder. Absolutely. You know, he gets up, he leaves his knees on the player. That's there's no need for that. And then Thomas makes the mistake of going there and talking to him. But this was all started by number 90 from Virginia.
Mariota down the middle, caught at the 10. Josh Huff. The throw was on the money, but that was a sensational catch for 30 yards.
And I'm not sure you could cover it any better. Draquan Hosky was right on it, but that was a very accurate throw, and Huff makes a tough catch.
And they're right back at it. Pick up maybe 4 for Marshall.
Huff, a guy who had a knee injury last year. That's an unbelievable catch. As he turns over, he got his hands underneath of it. But now, for Virginia, I think Virginia's got to start thinking about some timeouts here. 3 timeouts left. You're just going to let this clock melt. If you're in a game with Oregon, you need to go back on offense.
Huff goes to the slot left. Marshall is the running back.
And Oregon now, I think very smartly, I think they've gone to slow ball. Because if Virginia's not going to take the timeout, then let's try to milk it and score with no time left.
Option. That's a forward pass. Everybody thinks it's a fumble, but it's not. A shovel pass is a forward pass.
And now Oregon helps out Virginia with an incomplete pass, stopping the clock. But here goes Oregon fast. Good penetration again there by David Dean. This is a really good player in the middle for Virginia.
And that's something John Tenuta said they had to have. Marshall is going to be stopped short of the goal line. And now we've got more pushing and shoving.
And here goes Oregon fast. Virginia not even thinking timeout here.
And they're not going to be able to think touchdown either. The big guy does it again, Brent Urban.
And, you know, frankly, what great penetration that time by Urban. Going one-on-one against a very experienced center in Hironas. Grassu had just got the edge on him. But the problem for UVA now is they let the clock run down. If you use those timeouts as the clock's running down, maybe you have a minute 10, minute 15 seconds left. And now, I think for Virginia, they're not going to have a choice but just try to run it out. But this has been, for a lot of Virginia fans, especially after the Virginia Tech game last year, where everyone thought that the timeouts were mismanaged at the end of the game, used for icing the kicker instead of saving time for their offense. Same thing happened here. You're playing Oregon, you're down 18, and you haven't given your offense a chance here at the end of the half.
And Virginia just going to try to kill the clock. Oregon will call a timeout. We asked our Aflac trivia question. Marcus Mariota's 3,429 total yards in 2012, only ranked 2nd in Oregon single season history. Who was first? Ed Cunningham got it right last night. Akili Smith over almost 4,000 yards. It didn't work out for him in the pros. He was something at Oregon.
And I think he was a guy who early on in the development of this program, as we see it now, started to build there in the late 90s. I think Akili Smith was a guy that the country started looking at and saying, what are they doing out there at Oregon? Right. So I think it didn't pan out in the NFL, but I think Akili Smith was an important part of the growth of this program.
Oregon only has one timeout remaining, so as long as Virginia does not fumble or end up in the end zone.
And I'm not saying that Virginia would have done much more than this had they had more time on the clock, because ball's on the 1 yard line. We just want to get out of the half. But boy, I sure would want my offense to have a little more time if I've got those three timeouts, especially in a game like this.
Certainly might have given yourself a chance. So that's the last time Oregon can stop it.
But I like the idea of Oregon. Make them run another play. What if they fumble? What if you do something? Again, extend the quarters. Extend the half. Extend the game. Don't let it run down.
I mean, what happens if Virginia has a bad center quarterback exchange? You
make them run the play.
You never know exactly.
Make them punt if they're going to punt, even if it's the last play.
That's what they do on their extra point plays. They make people defend the field, and if you make a mistake, they'll go for two instead of one. Watford with the keeper, and the ball did come loose. That's why you call a timeout and make them run a play, because that happens.
Kaylee Ekipi, the nose guard, was squatted over the center, meaning really low on Ross Burbank, and Burbank short-armed it. And Virginia, incredibly lucky, because on a turnover, the clock stops. Oregon would have been able to run a play from about the 3 yard line.
Let's check in with Janine.
Coach, you told me before the game we weren't going to have time for replays. You were right. Not much has changed with this Oregon offense in your second game as head coach, but how are you trying to put your own twist on things?
Couldn't be further from the last thing on my mind. We need to score touchdowns when we have chances like that, and going the other way, we have to convert that other turnover, but just not efficient enough offensively right now.
The thinking right now with the timeouts there of extending the quarter, what went into that?
Well, as you saw right there, they fumbled the snap, and that's a high anxiety situation for the center quarterback exchange. And I thought, you know, there are a couple chances there for us to make plays.
And it worked. We'll see you in second half, Coach. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Janine. At the half here in Charlottesville, our score is Oregon 28, Virginia 10. When we come back, the studio catches you up on everything in college football at the half after these messages. Welcome back to the ACC on ESPN. We're in Charlottesville, where the Virginia Cavaliers are at home facing the number two team in the country, the Ducks of Oregon. It's 28-10. Yes, Oregon has burned Virginia.
And you look at Oregon defensively, and I know they lost a bunch of their linebackers, especially Deion Jordan in the first round. This is not the same defense they had last year. If David Watford for Virginia can get some type of vertical pass game going, they haven't been able to hit any long throws. They've been able to get a little bit of the run game going, but it's been more moving the pocket, letting this young man throw the ball a little bit with rhythm. If he can get some long balls, this game could get interesting, because offensively, Oregon's a little sloppy and haven't converted two fourth downs so far in the ball game.
And Virginia will get the ball to start the third quarter. Shorter kick this time taken by Shepherd. And he's cut down to 21. Let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary, Ed.
It's exactly who we talked about in the open. Marcus Mariota, the very first time Oregon, as the ball goes 80 yards and and just shows the speed runs right by the safeties of Virginia. And then, of course, DeAnthony Thomas gets going, was running the ball, having some trouble inside. So then they decided, well, let's take number six and bounce him outside. He outruns the safeties of Virginia. And then Braylon Addison, a guy who maybe doesn't quite have the speed of some of those stars, but awfully good in space, gets in on the run.
Virginia going for the home run on first down, and a step overthrown intended for Adrian Gamble. Gamble covered well by Terrence Mitchell, but he had a step.
He did.
The ball was just a step overthrown.
Can't overthrow that ball because it was good coverage by Mitchell, but when he's trailing, and that's something Steve Fairchild will have to work with his young quarterback. If anything, you want to underthrow that ball a little bit, let your receiver lean back into the defender and see if you can't get pass interference. But you overthrow that, it's going to be incomplete 100% of the time.
Toss will get about 3 yards. Kevin Parks will check in with Janine.
Well, Mike and Ed, Virginia coach Mike London told me that Oregon is playing a full 2 seconds faster than BYU played against them last week. They're running a play every 14 seconds. And he said, we've had a few slight issues with subbing, but most of all, our defense has gotten a little bit gassed. He said, but we missed an awful lot of opportunities in that first quarter. Our sloppiness, we were beating ourselves. But I can tell you, in speaking with some of the assistant coaches as they came out for Virginia, this team does not feel defeated yet. They kept saying, we're okay, we're okay. I haven't seen frustration.
All right, Janine, big third down here as they would like to keep this opening drive of the second half alive, and Watford just has to throw it away because of pressure and tremendous coverage. I did notice if they're running plays every 14 seconds, there were a couple of times in the first half, Ed, where they would run a wide play, and the defensive linemen had barely gotten back to their spots, not even in their stance, and the next play was started.
It's almost impossible to get ready. I don't care if you run three huddles with your scout team. It's really hard to run it. Plus, your scout team's just not going to run it with the speed and efficiency of these guys. It's impossible to really get ready for them, and that's why you've seen it for the first time. It's really tough to defend.
They try to come after the kicker, and he gets off a poor punt as a result of it. Marked near the 45-yard line, only a 32-yard kick off the side of his foot, and certainly Virginia's had kicking issues as we have an injured Oregon player.
It's Eric Dargan, who was slow to get up after that punt return, a guy who works into the safety rotation.
The NASCAR season comes down to this. Jimmy Johnson ahead of the pack with the playoffs just a week away. The final shot to lock up a spot in the chase. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series just about an hour from here at Richmond tonight, 7 Eastern on ABC. And Oregon with the hurry up. And it's Thomas. Well, you just hold your breath every time he turns the corner. Picked up 9. Thomas again on that option read look. What a cut. Gets to the outside, steps out of bounds, first down at the Virginia 33-yard line. Now they'll move it to the 31.
Jake Fisher, the right tackle guy with a ton of talent. Watch this block on the outside. Good hands inside. And as the defensive end goes down inside, outside linebacker Daquan Romero just shoves him right in there.
Pressure. And Mariotti trying to keep the play alive as long as he could before he threw it away.
And the rule for the quarterback, the reason this is not intentional grounding, it doesn't matter that the ball went out of bounds. As long as at some point it goes beyond the line of scrimmage and the quarterback is outside the tackle box, it's not intentional grounding.
One of the few times he has felt pressure. Quarterback keeper straight up the middle. Same kind of play he broke for a huge gain in the first quarter. And Marcus Mariota.
And that was a slant call on the defensive front by John Tenuta. They do that a lot, and the backside defensive end, Eli Howard, came crashing down, and nobody was home. It was called that way, and nobody home.
Mariota throws to the 1 yard line just past up. Had him and missed him. Maurice Kennedy on the coverage for the Cavaliers.
It's amazing as fast as they go. This now feels like, oh boy, they're really slow. Whenever they take this long to get the play in,
It's unbelievable. It feels like this is in molasses.
You know, the other thing, as fast as they go, you think they'd have a lot of motion penalties. They don't. Mariota hanging in the pocket, throws intended for Huff again. Incomplete.
One of the things that this offense is great at, and of course Mark Helfrich, who came here in 2009 from Colorado, they don't do a lot of shifts and motions and things because it actually slows you down. So a lot of times they just line up and go. There's really no motion in this offense, so that really helps them on those penalties.
Mariota has struggled with his accuracy in the passing game a week ago, doing it again today. He's only 8 out of 18. Blitz coming. Screen against it and dropped. Boy, they had the perfect call against the blitz.
And Oregon just not looking very good finishing drives. I'm not sure. The defensive line actually did a really nice job. Again, David Dean having a great game. He actually slow rushes. Nice job by 55. He read the screen and stayed home. All the three other defensive linemen were making penetration, but Oregon not able to finish drive, letting Virginia hang around.
So they will go for the field goal. Maldonado. He's true, and it's 31-10. The second-ranked Ducks over the Cavaliers. It will be two of college football's most storied teams for the final time in Ann Arbor, Michigan tonight. Notre Dame and Michigan, respectively ranked 14th and 17th for the last time in this historic series. Primetime college football presented by Hampton Hotels tonight at 8 o'clock. If you hold Oregon to a field goal, I think your defense can say they've won. And that's what Virginia did on the last drive. Here's Robert Flores with an update.
Mike, right now on ESPN, after allowing Georgia to score 17 unanswered points, South Carolina goes 12 plays, 84 yards. Brandon Wilds with the score. Second quarter, time running. Georgia still leading 17-10 on ESPN.
All right, Robert, thanks very much. Well, that is a big early season matchup.
For Georgia especially.
Sure is.
SEC East foe. Aaron Murray didn't play so well against Clemson, against that defensive front.
See what Watford can do on this play. The time of possession is off the charts, but it makes no difference whatsoever. Mizell in space, taken down after a gain of 5 by Derek Malone, the weak side linebacker. Makes a lot of tackles. They have a lot of tackles to make up from in this linebacker core. They've lost two terrific players.
Bad news for Oregon is Tony Washington goes limping off. But yeah, they lost. Oregon lost Kiko Alonso and Michael Clay in the middle. Of course, Deion Jordan, who's a first-round pick. And in talking to Nick Aliotti, the longtime defensive coordinator for Oregon, you're missing a lot of leadership. Alonso and Clay had played a ton of ball. They'd seen every type of offense. They just don't quite have that leader. And we've heard about Marcus Mariota working on his leadership on the other side of the ball. But they're missing it a bit here on the defensive side as well.
The heralded recruit, Taquan Mizell, is the tailback, and he'll get the carry. And Smoke will pick up about 3. It's a tough nickname to live up to.
Smoke?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, how about a little smoke and mirrors here? You got 3rd and short. Pack everybody in. I think the only way Virginia gets back into this game, and they took a shot with Gamble. They threw a long one there, but this feels like on a 3rd and short where Oregon's going to think inside run or some type of power edge run.
Mizell goes out. Shepard checks back in at tailback. UVA only 3 out of 13 converting 3rd downs. Shepard goes to the flat, and they'll throw it to him. Got to get the 1st down on his own, and a great effort, and he does. So you see the reason Shepard came back in, a little more veteran player, probably a little bit better receiver than Mizell.
And the hard part is if you're Oregon, you have this defendant, Viseko Lacombo, a guy that all the coaches are saying has the ability, should be an NFL prospect, but that's just a missed open field tackle. And there's where you start to see the linebackers that Oregon is missing off of last year's team, I think.
It's odd to hear them talk about a senior linebacker having great potential. You don't have that much time to
And frankly, with the guys they had playing, it was hard for Lucumbo to get on the field a ton. Absolutely. He did play, but he's a very explosive guy. But you see there in the open field, waiting for him to click in totally. And I think if there are dings in Oregon, I don't see the power run game that they had with Barnietto, though we're hearing we may see this young man, Thomas Tyner, but the leadership on defense in that linebacker spot is not as good as last year looking so far.
Second and nine for the Cavaliers. Over the middle, Swanson, the tight end, with a first down across midfield. They've utilized the tight ends very well, and they got a couple of good ones in Swanson and McGee.
Standing up away from the line of scrimmage. Just runs right down the middle, exactly where you'd expect the hole to be.
That's four catches for Thompson, or for Swanson. For the tight ends overall, that's nine grabs.
Virginia getting a little bit of an offensive drive going. How huge is this for their defense to be able to come over and cool their heels a little bit?
Right now, everything's big for them. First downs, potential scores. When Oregon gets the ball back trying to stop them, I mean, it's all huge.
Your touchdown here in your Virginia. Make something happen on defensive turnover. This game's not over.
Make it interesting, couldn't it? Great throw that time, and McGee makes the catch. The Oregon 37, that's his sixth grab.
McGee's a guy that Steve Fairchild, the offensive coordinator, said, if you're playing pickup basketball, you want this guy because he's going to body up and get a rebound. He's got good hands. Not extremely fast, or he just got a great feel for the pass game, and that time in traffic makes a tough catch.
And that wasn't one of those little checkdowns. He was a little deeper that time. Parks is back in. It's a tailback. They like to run him between the tackles. They'd like to run him for a little more than that.
And that's one, as your quarterback starts to get a little better feel in David Watford. They do allow him to audible out of things and get numbers, but that time Oregon clearly shifted their defense over when he reset the formation to put the strength to his left. And as they go forward, they weren't outnumbered necessarily, but as they go forward, they may let this young quarterback in Watford say, you know, maybe we run this back to the backside, or I can call a pass, because that looked like running into the teeth of the defense. Not sure how much you want to do that.
Watford fumbles it and drops on it. An unforced error that will cost him 5 yards and a precious down.
And I think we saw a nervous snap from Ross Burbank at the end of the half. That one comes end over. It should have been caught, but you expect that ball to come in as a spiral. But again, Oregon has defenders on his nose, and Burbank, who was off last week, if you studied the film, which obviously Oregon did, the snaps were off quite a bit for Burbank, with a true nose guard for BYU. And so Oregon, Nick Aliotti, putting a guy on the nose to get this center nervous.
10th play of the drive. Mizell cuts it back, breaks the tackle. Down to the 38-yard line. That'll bring up 4th and 11.
And I think you
now
have to,
I think you're looking at going for it, aren't you?
Well, I've been arguing you should never punt to Oregon when you're a little over man, but this is definitely a situation. Now the problem is it's 4th and 10 plus, not quite 11. And we have not seen a lot of long routes by UVA. You need protection. You're going to spread them out. If I'm Oregon, I might bring a blitz here. At least one guy. Only three rushers showing now. But this is going to take a while to develop.
They bring the fourth. And the pass is intercepted at the 25-yard line. Great coverage by Rodney Hardrick. The middle linebacker had terrific position. The pass may have been a little late, and it cost them.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Aflac, official partner of the Heisman Trophy, Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy, and AT&T, rethink possible.
It's It's a statue of Meriwether Lewis and William Clark, who spent 3 years going from Central Virginia to the state of Oregon on one of the famous Lewis and Clark expeditions. You really have to go to want to get there if you're going to take 3 years.
How long would it take Oregon with this offense to get across the Lewis and Clark Trail these days?
15 seconds. This will pick up considerable yardage for Byron Marshall. And there is...
flag came late.
A flag down.
It's from the back judge, who's the official.
By the offense, number 16, 10 yards, replay, second down.
I was going to say, it had to be a wide receiver. That time it was Darrell Hawkins, because the back judge is watching one of the receivers, not watching the line of scrimmage. So
he was holding Anthony Harris, who received so much acclaim a week ago, and that went over BYU, and this will back them up. Mariota taking his time under pressure, throws over the middle, and Braylon Addison makes the catch. He'll be about 2 yards shy of a first down.
It's amazing as you watch this offense as they go fast. You just don't see a lot of in-the-pocket passing. It almost looks a little odd.
And look at how quickly they get this playoff. And very close to a first down is Marshall. Stopped by Romero. Looks like he may be just a few inches shy. No, he's got a first down.
And that's what Mariota, when we were talking to him about the most important part of his job, is just rhythm. He said, don't think about big plays. Don't think about anything other than what's the rhythm of our offense, and pick up a first down and keep going.
Mariota with a fake and then throws to Keenan Lowe. And Lowe inside the Virginia 40. You've got to hand it to the Oregon players, particularly the linemen, to have the discipline that they do to get back to the line of scrimmage, to get in their stance and be ready for another play that quickly.
But it's everything in the program is suited to that. So the strength trainer actually trains the offensive lineman on how to run fast. They spend time doing everything to get fast.
Thomas back in the ballgame on a sweep. Blocker in front, used it very well, picked up 10. He had big Hieronis Grassu, 6'3", 297, the center pulling, and a very patient run by a very fast running back.
It's really hard when you're snapping the ball to then back out. It's almost a little dance step that Grassu uses to back out of that. Not much of a block, but he's had a couple of really nice blocks on outside runs today.
Thomas again. Stiff arm picks him up 2 yards. Romero, another tackle.
I will say, and I still do think that Oregon is not quite as good in the inside run game as they were last year for obvious reasons, but that's the second time I've seen DeAnthony Thomas use a stiff arm. I would say for a small guy, he's got a pretty powerful one.
It's pretty tough. 5'9", 171. He'll stick his nose right in there. Nice throw that time by Mariota. And he got it to Huff, who's on the Biletnikoff list this year as the best wide receiver candidate in the country.
So hard for a defense when that looks like just a normal pocket pass, but there's an entire run action that the linebackers have to honor every time.
Don't blink, you'll miss it. Byron Marshall this time.
But going back to what you were saying, the linemen, Oregon's offensive linemen are not 330, 340-pound guys. 280, 290, 300. And a lot of it is because they have to be able to go that fast. But again, a lot of what they work on in the offseason is about speed as much as power.
Well, if they were 330 after a month of camp, they'd be down to 280, wouldn't they?
Yeah, I don't think if this was an NFL team, you'd have to find many linemen for being overweight.
Yeah, that's for sure. To the outside, nice cut back down to the three. DeAnthony Thomas, and it's a touchdown. His third score of the ball game. That is some special runner.
And Virginia had it defended, standing right there, ready to make the tackle on the backside as the strong safety, Anthony Harris, and unfortunately
Thomas has that ability to put his foot in the ground and go the other direction, I think, faster than anybody in the country. I think DeAnthony Thomas change direction is, it's as good as I've seen. I played with a guy named Napoleon Kaufman at the University of Washington.
Oh, yeah.
And this guy may be even in change of direction quicker than Napoleon was.
They will kick it conventionally with Maldonado.
Well, the only way to make it look like you might have a chance is to put it at 200 frames a second and watch him cut back. But that cut, there was no chance for Harris to make that tackle after that cut.
Welcome back to Charlottesville. 38-10, number two Oregon has extended its lead to four scores, trying to put this game away. Khalid Shepard has some room to run. Blockers in front. Cut out instead of in. Taken down at the 28. Here's Robert Flores with an update. Robert?
All right, Mike, time now for a Taco Bell Live Moss moment. Great game right now on ESPN. Todd Gurley puts Georgia on top after South Carolina has scored 14 unanswered points. Late first half, Bulldogs up 24-17.
Two powerful football teams knocking heads this afternoon in that one, that's for sure. Virginia starts from its own 28. Watford under pressure, and he was blasted and lost the ball. Tony Washington, and a recovery for Oregon. Washington got around the corner and unloaded on Watford. Balducci with the recovery for the Ducks.
Defensive end standing up, three down linemen. They use that other defensive end as an outside linebacker. Good hand play by Washington. The right tackle, Whitmire, went to reach for him. He slapped the hands right at the right time. Watford never saw him coming. One-on-one blocking, and this is where Oregon, you start to see them as a program, these defensive linemen. I played against these guys in the early 90s. They were not this good on the defensive front, I'll tell you that.
Marshall. We'll pick up a couple, and let's check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, guys, despite the fact that Chip Kelly is getting ready for his first game at the helm of the Eagles on Monday Night Football, he took the time to give me a couple of comments on his former offensive coordinator, Mark Helfrich. You know, they still speak on a regular basis. Kelly is close with several coaches on the Oregon staff. He texts them regularly. Helfrich, interestingly, said, as we see a fumble there, interestingly said, we don't talk about football, we talk about everything but Kelly said that Helfrich is not only an outstanding football coach, one of the most intelligent guys he's ever been around, and the players relate extremely well to him. And Helfrich said that Kelly, because he is now coaching the Eagles, has turned Helfrich, a lifelong Dallas Cowboys fan, into someone rooting for the Eagles.
All right, thanks, Janine. And they have certainly kept the continuity going in Oregon. You saw that last drop by Lyerla. He'll never have an easier catch to make in his life. Third down and long. And a first down near the 10, and it's Braylon Addison. That's his third catch. They have real great hopes for him. He's a wonderful blocker downfield, which really helps the running game and can make big, big plays. Throw for the end zone, knocked away by Harris.
Harris
did a defensive job against Hawkins.
Nice job by Harris. He was out of position, got there late, and it looked like Mariota was trying to get this ball out of his hands a little faster. And remember, in college football, there's no such thing as face guarding, so there's no penalty for not turning around and finding the ball, and Harris played that ball perfect.
Second and 10. Oregon substituted, so Virginia has the same option. And the officials will wait until the players can make that exchange. Flanker screen, low. Touchdown. You've got so many different ways to hurt you. Josh Huff at 5'11", 190, threw him a block to spring him, and Keenan Lowe did the rest. They run a couple of plays, doesn't look like much, and then boom.
The way you play defense. defense in this game has changed so drastically. In the last 10 years, how do you defend that? If you have this much speed and you're Virginia, how do you defend that?
Apparently not very well. Nobody does. Nobody has. Oregon now having its way with the Virginia Cavaliers. The Ducks are up 45-10. Mariota has led the onslaught here in the second half, and Mike London, who was so encouraged by last week's win over BYU, looking more and more dejected on the sideline today.
Well, this game obviously not over, but you have to think for Mike London, and I know the Virginia fans, they were thinking probably 0-2 with BYU coming in here last week. So starting with BYU getting the win and then looking like a loss here, if you're Virginia, I think you got to be pretty happy if you're sitting at 1-1 after these two opening ball games.
Jennings and Shepard are deep, and they'll take a knee. You know how much respect I have for John Tenuta as a defensive coordinator. I think he's one of the best there is. He said, well, they haven't reinvented the game. They haven't reinvented the wheel, but I'll tell you this, they put better tires on it.
The thing that Oregon and the modern spread offense, I think, that has changed the game is if you go back to all the misdirection stuff with the wing tee and the single wing and those things back in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, there was no vertical pass game. And you didn't have guys with the speed that Oregon has. The difference being, too, a lot of that was done around the line of scrimmage. Now sure. Everybody's spread out. So I think the modern offenses are not just misdirecting using the width of the field, but they're also using the vertical stretch of the field, unlike those old offenses.
This is Parks. Slides his way out to the 30.
And the hard part for Virginia, if they really do want to have this pro style, very similar to what Alabama runs, power run game, it is going to really come down to recruiting up front for Steve Fairchild and this offensive staff. They're going to have to go get big, powerful offensive line. They're pretty good at that position now, but I just think they're going to have to get much better up front if UVA wants to really embrace this offense.
Watford, flanker screen. They get it out to Shepard. You know, I asked Scott Frost, who's now the new offensive coordinator for it, as we have a player down.
That's Shepard, who's one of the only guys in space who's been able to do anything for Virginia today, so that would be a huge loss.
Able to put weight on it and get off the field. But I asked Scott Frost, have you seen any evidence the defenses have found a way to counter a really good spread offense? And he said, no, they haven't, because the space, you can't cover the space.
Scott Frost, of course, moving up to offensive coordinator when Helfrich took the job as the head man. Chip Kelly left for the NFL.
Watford underneath. Nice catch, but a yard shy of the first down for Tim Smith. And here comes the punt team. Little surprised on fourth and one that you don't.
You're punting the ball away and saying this feels a little bit like the white flag to me. I think you have to go for it on fourth down.
Vosanolik will kick. Well, if you were ever going to go for it on fourth down, I would have thought that would have been the opportunity. Addison makes the fair catch. We'll check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, Mike, this counts as the furthest east the Oregon Ducks have traveled since 1970. And the two gentlemen behind me, Bob Striegel and Gary Riley, drove 20,000 pounds of Oregon football equipment 2,800 miles across the country. It took 44 hours. And you know what? They made no overnight stops. They traveled through 12 states, Wyoming, Missouri, Nevada, to name a few. And on Thursday afternoon, they pulled in here to Charlottesville. And you know what? Tonight, they're going to pack everything up and drive it all back. They both told me that's the furthest they have ever driven. I think they get the game ball.
Well, Lewis and Clark would have gotten it 150 years ago, but I'm in your corner, Janine. Now that would be tough duty, to drag all that equipment across country in 3 years. You play the game, and then you load it up and start back.
Well, you have to bring 15 different types of uniforms and helmets because you're not sure what they're going to wear on game day. Although that's a joke. They pick it before they leave.
I like these.
If they loaded up the entire equipment room at Oregon, they'd need 5 trucks.
Yeah. These helmets, I think, are have a special look. Daquan Romero with another tackle. Boy, has he been active. That's pretty.
You know, it's interesting. You talk to the players from Oregon, and one of the things they're proud of, and you can hear it, is that we're no longer just the school out west with cool helmets.
Yeah.
We're actually playing to a level where it really isn't about the uniforms. And in their recruiting, they actually want to know, are you coming because we look cool, or are you coming because you want to play at Oregon?
They'll try the sweep with Marshall, and Marshall hitting the backfield and taken down by David Dean, big number 55. A lot of the uniforms they trotted out there I haven't cared for, but I think these look really sharp.
Well, they're backing it up. If you look at Oregon and you've studied them over the last 5 years, the program that they've built feels like it's built for the long haul to stay in the top 10 or 15 every single year.
Absolutely. Well, that's the end of the third quarter here in Charlottesville, and Oregon has taken command. The second-ranked Ducks lead the Cavaliers 45-10. 45-10 over Virginia. Ducks getting ready to punt, surprisingly enough, for the fourth time today. And Dominique Terrell waits at his own 38. Nice kick again. Out of bounds, no chance of a return. Let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary from Charlottesville, and it's been mostly Ducks. Cavaliers made a game of it. Mariota, 321 yards in total offense. Now, this is not the slaughter that they racked up last week against Nicholls State. Thomas, 124 yards rushing. Watford passed for 133, but had 2 picks. And really missed a couple of big throws downfield that could have changed the direction of this game. Watford again, flanker screen, diagnosed perfectly by Dior Mathis.
Well, if you're going to play a team like Oregon, who we've seen is as good as anyone in the country running the wide receiver screen, you better be pretty good at it. And watching Virginia against BYU and here today, their wide receiver screens just take too long to develop. They need to get more movement so that the defense can't start breaking on that ball. Taking a little too long to get going.
And just in practice, Oregon defensive backs see about the best people running this flanker screen they're going to see all year long.
But I'm going to go back to Watford. You know, you talked about he did miss a couple of long throws. I will, from what I saw against BYU, from this young quarterback, a guy who played in 2011 as a freshman, then was redshirted last year with the Rocco Sims debacle that went back and forth. A lot of people thought Watford may transfer himself, a highly recruited young man from that Tidewater area you were talking right about. But the growth between the first game and the second game, and it's going to come out a loss, I think is pretty drastic for Watford from what I've seen.
Clearly made progress, no doubt. Parks back in his tailback. He stays in as a blocker. The pass intended for Darius Jennings, and a flag comes in late. That'll either be holding or interference.
I believe there's going to get Dior Mathis. Dior Mathis.
Pass interference by the defense, number 3. 15 yards, automatic first down.
Dior Mathis gets the call.
A nice part for Nick Aliotti and his defensive staff at Oregon. They're able to start getting some time for some of the defensive backs that don't play. Mathis not in the normal rotation.
So Virginia will have a first down at the Oregon 47-yard line. Watford throws underneath, complete to Tim Smith. Out of Chesapeake, Virginia, and Troy Hill makes the tackle.
I do think that Virginia has something to build on offensively. They're not going to be super explosive. They're very limited, I think. They don't quite have the speed players that you need, I think, at this point to be competitive within the ACC. But I think they can build on this.
Watford going through his progressions, throws late to the right side, incomplete. Troy Hill in the coverage. We'll check in again with Robert Flores. Robert.
Hey, Mike, crazy game on ESPN between South Carolina and Georgia. Connor Shaw, Nick Jones right before halftime. Second time that combo has worked for a touchdown. They're tied at 24 on ESPN at the break. Coming up on ABC later tonight, Jeff Gordon has the pole position in Virginia, but he's 6 points out of the chase.
Really like Connor Shaw. Jake McGee makes that catch, has enough for a first down. Good job by McGee. He has 7 catches in this game. And through the first two, 10 grabs. Now Virginia trying to hurry up a little bit. All day. And now Watford will get what he can and get out of bounds at the 30-yard line.
If I'm a Virginia fan and I watched BYU closely last week and then this week I'm watching my quarterback, everything looks smoother. He's starting to look like a quarterback again. He's a guy who had to run the scout team last year. By all reports, did a great job, never flinched, stayed focused, but even on that little one there, he took off faster. As soon as it wasn't there, and last week that would have been a little bit of a hesitation.
You can also see he's got his head on a swivel. He's going through his reads. If his primary's not there, he's looking for somebody else. E.J. Scott, nicknamed the Squirrel, makes the catch. E.J. Scott came out with a Twitter handle, Feed the Squirrel, because he wasn't getting the ball. That's his first catch.
Squirrel only needs one nut to be full.
But he's out there looking for another one. Winter's coming. Watford over the middle. This one knocked away and good contact. Back there by the middle linebacker, Rodney Hardrick, who had that earlier interception on a fine defensive play.
And this is one of those ones when you're in training, when they're training officials, anytime the defender gets there what looks like the same time as the ball, never throw the flag. That's one thing where they do let the defense, they get there right at it. Even if it's a click early, they're not going to throw it.
Watford again underneath to his tight end. McGee, been a busy fellow. He'll have a first down.
This is really important work for Virginia. As this season goes on, and they have a brutal back half of the schedule within their own conference, but this drive here is actually something that Mike London and his staff can build on. Oregon obviously feeling comfortable, not quite as explosive defensively as they were earlier, but this is a nice drive for Virginia maybe to be able to build on as the season goes on.
Little toss to Parks, and he's inside the 10. As you mentioned, their schedule, they get a week off, then VMI, Pitt, Ball State, Maryland, Duke, Georgia Tech. Then they get number 4, Clemson. They get them here, then at North Carolina, at Miami, a team that looked pretty good today. And then that traditional game against Virginia Tech on November 30th.
And this is a team, frankly, you get to 6 or 7 wins if you're a Cavalier fan. You've got to think that improvement was made.
Blitz coming, Watford throws, touchdown, Dominique Terrell. Watford handled himself very well there, just stood in the pocket with heat coming.
Well,
but I checked the penalty.
Yeah, I think they might get offensive pass interference here. This looked like a runoff route by McGee.
There were fouls by both teams on the play. Pass interference by the offense, number 83. Personal foul, roughing the passer, contact high on the quarterback by the defense. Those fouls offset. Replay, second down.
McGee is the tight end. Does he pick a defender?
Yeah. That's a pick. You have to at least attempt to avoid the defender, and that time he made.
Whoa.
Well, to me, that's not a penalty. I think that's the referee has his flag, but that was low in the chest, did not go up to the head.
So I think it was late, though.
A little bit late, but he didn't call that. He said he was going to the quarterback's head, and I didn't see Lacumbo going to the head at all there.
Watford chased. Comes back to his outlet, Parks. Parks will lose some. Christian French, a sophomore, gets a stop.
French, one of those defensive ends with Washington, who we saw go off with an injury earlier, that plays more on 2 feet and with a hand on the ground. And Oregon playing a lot more three defensive line front than they had in years past. They're trying to build. They're trying to build a defense where with three down linemen, they can control the five offensive linemen. That's the goal for Oregon.
Blitz coming, sellout. Watford throws for the end zone, and it's intercepted. Picked off by Mathis. Deion Mathis with a blocker in front, cuts it back. Still on his feet. Gets another block and another. Mathis with a chance and knocked out of bounds inside the five by Jay Whitmire, the offensive tackle who would not give up. A return of 97 yards. It was actually more, but the NCAA only recognizes from the goal line to the spot, not how far it's in the end zone.
And I actually give a lot of credit here to the quarterback, David Watford. Watch Watford coming down, makes Mathis change direction, because stays on his feet and makes Mathis try to outrun him and slow down. And while he slowed down, big number 77, Whitmire, was still tracking, and there is no way that Mathis is going to be let off the hook tomorrow in film when his defensive mates see that he was tackled by a 300-pound offensive tackle.
Jeff Locke is the new quarterback, and the new running back, Thomas Tyner, the five-star recruit out of Aloha, Oregon. And when we talk about kids coming out of high school with big reputations, let me throw a number at you. 643 yards and 10 touchdowns. Doesn't sound like much, but that was one game. 643 and 10
and
in one game.
All of the Oregon fans who are still here are so happy to finally see number 24 on the field. Young man sprained his ankle during training camp. There was a penalty on the PAT for Oregon, but this young man came in as a huge recruit, 10.35 in the 100 meters at 211 pounds, and the coaches said it's not been since 2007 with Jonathan Stewart, who was an All-American, that we've had this combination of size and speed, and not bad. First carry of his collegiate career, 6 points, not bad.
Good way to start. Oregon converts, and the Ducks certainly by now put it out of reach. 52-10 over Virginia. It's 52-10. The Oregon Ducks solidifying their number two spot in the poll with this big win. 9:40 to go.
I will say, though, if you're Oregon and you're going back, you have a lot to work on. They left, I mean, it sounds crazy, but at least 28 points on this field. And defensively, a couple times, they looked like they could be moved on. So I think the number two team in the country against a team that's going to finish towards the bottom part of their division in the ACC, I think Oregon's got their work cut out for them.
Jennings on the return. Isn't it nice, though, when you can be leading 52-10 and you can find things you think you can criticize? They're pretty good anyway. We'll be back to Charlottesville, a new quarterback for the Cavaliers, Grayson Lambert, when we come back.
Double miles you can actually use.
Beautiful Monticello just outside of Charlottesville, designed, built, and lived in by Thomas Jefferson, the third president of the United States. And Scott Matthews, our producer, saying projected as a very high pick in the American history draft. I would think Lincoln would have to go first, maybe Jefferson second.
You know, blew me away about Monticello when I went to visit it? It's tiny. small. You look at it, you see it up on the hill, you think, oh, that's probably 3,000-4,000 square feet, and you go in, and of course that was the times they didn't build many mansions, but
well, they didn't have a weight room to build, so. The new quarterback, Grayson Lambert, a redshirt freshman out of Jessup, Georgia. And Lambert wants to throw. That's incomplete. Let's check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, Mike, in case you were looking for me on the sideline, I'm up here in the Virginia press box where Walter Matthau and George Burns have nothing on these two Sunshine Boys. I want to introduce you to John Risher and Paul Wiseman. At 103 and 88 years young, these two gentlemen have a combined 58 years of statistician service here for the University of Virginia. Dr. Risher is the Virginia's oldest living alum. He actually played on the 1931 football team. And Mr. Wiseman, well, he hasn't missed a home game here since 1946. These gentlemen told me the toughest part of their job right now is just getting in and out of the stadium. I wouldn't be surprised if they have writer's cramp trying to keep up with the tempo of this game. But these are two gems.
Yes, they are. Janine, that's a wonderful story. And gentlemen, our tip of the cap to you for your long and continuous service with a school that's built on tradition. What could you ask for more than that? And a flag down, may have been interference with the receiver on the punt.
This is that same rule.
Yes, they did not call earlier.
Shoulders wide and a yard in front of the return man. It looks like DJ Hill.
Kick catch interference by the kicking team. 15 yards, first down, timeout.
And that's a big penalty.
Got a timeout, 8:49 to go. They'll count us down on how many timeouts we've got left in this ball game. Thank you, gentlemen. He's already had his first carry go for a touchdown. Overall, I know you cited some things that you thought Oregon could work on, but overall, does this look like a national championship contender to you?
I think it does, because I think all the teams at the top have major flaws. I think Ohio State's defense is going to be suspect a few times this year. Alabama's offensive line against Virginia Tech, they didn't look
false start
average.
By the offense,
they looked
number 62
average.
5 yards, second down.
Well, they lost a lot of talent on the line too.
When you saw who they lost on that offensive line, and we saw it against Virginia Tech. But that middle of the schedule at Washington, who looked good against Boise State, but let's wait to see how good Boise State really is. And then UCLA, who obviously is on the upswing under Jim Mora Jr. It's a tough schedule in conference. And of course, Stanford, another team in the northern part of the Pac-12 that seems stuck in the top 10 for perpetuity, at least for the next few years.
And so. Stanford, of course, the team that broke their heart a year ago. Mm-hmm. Complete pass to Blake Stanton, the junior out of Los Angeles. He's 5'11", 220.
But I think the part that if I were Oregon or I were an Oregon fan, I'd be worried about is that linebacker spot. It's awfully tough when there goes Kiner. Well, there's that speed there.
Holy smokes.
But this is an offensive line touchdown, though, here, because it doesn't take 10-3-5 in the 100 meters to run this touchdown after the blocking young Tyner had up front.
That's all right. He'll claim it anyway.
Backup offensive line in. Nice block by true freshman right tackle Cameron Hunt in there for Jake Fisher. So a lot of young guys. But and talking to Nick Alioti, the defensive coordinator from Oregon, that's his concern, that linebacker. I think a team like Stanford that can run it, they could start to wear this group out potentially.
Well, Tyner's only played 2 minutes and 12 seconds in his career. Not a bad start. 51 yards and 2 touchdowns.
Just as advertised, I guess, huh?
Let's take a look at Allstate's good hands play this afternoon. And it was the interception by Mathis in the end zone. brought it out from 5 yards deep, weaved his way back and forth across the end zone. And Jay Whitmire, you got to give the big fella credit. He wouldn't give up, knocked him out of bounds inside the five. Officially, it's a 97-yard return because nothing from the end zone to the goal line counts. Don't know why, but it never has.
I'm giving Whitmire the good hands there, because did you see him go in and try to take the ball away as they were going out of bounds? I'm giving Whitmire that good hands play.
Little screen out here to Mizell, and he's chased out of bounds. And we'll check in with Robert Flores. Robert?
Hey, Mike, we're trying something a little new for the AT&T All-America Player of the Week nominee. How about the Miami defense as a collection? They forced 5 turnovers in their upset win over number 12 Florida, 21-16. You can text VOTE to 34763. Second straight week that an ACC team beats an SEC team.
It was a good opening week for the ACC, and that really added to it.
If you, Al Golden, who was an assistant here under Al Groh several years ago, I got to know Golden when he was here, met with him a few times. He was one of those guys that you just knew got it. And Miami is a place with even the NCAA hanging over their head, wondering what's going to happen with the penalties. He's been able to put together some recruiting classes, and you need those anchor tenants in a conference. If Miami plays well, Florida State plays well, this is a strong conference football-wise.
Well, within 15 miles of that campus, you could fill up about 6 really good football teams for the town that's down there. This would be a first down for the Cavaliers. Complete pass by Grayson Lambert. 2 days, Monday Night Football returns to ESPN with a pair of games. We'll start at 6:55, the Eagles and the Redskins. Then 10:15, it's the Texans and the Chargers. Our coverage begins with Monday Night Countdown at 5, then the Monday Night Doubleheader, 6:55 and 10:15 on ESPN as well as ESPN Live.
Well, it's funny, you know, we've talked to a bunch of defensive coordinators over the last couple of years, and you love to ask them, how do you defend the spread? What would you do? You kind of get their opinion. Well, all of them say, well, you need 3 or 4 really big defensive linemen, and then everybody else needs to be able to cover man-on-man, which, of course, at the college level,
nobody has.
Can't do. But at the NFL level, some teams can do that.
Yes,
so
it'll
be really interesting to see what type of offense Chip Kelly runs with the Eagles.
Well, I think every team that has run a lot of option offense has found out one thing. You expose your quarterback enough, he's going to get hurt. And you can't, that's a quarterback-centric league. You cannot get them hurt.
You certainly cannot, in my opinion, run your starting quarterback as much as you do in the collegiate level once you get to the NFL. The hits are too vicious. The guys are too big. I think you have to have an element of it in that, and we're seeing that throughout professional football now. There, a lot of people have that zone read element, but I agree. You don't want 10 or 15 carries a game for the quarterback now.
Lambert draw play to Kevin Parks out of Salisbury, North Carolina.
You know,
he's there between the tackles guy.
One of the things that NFL coaches talk about with the spread offense is when you get to the NFL, the hashes where the ball lines up, if it goes to the right or the left, are much more narrow than they are in college football. In the NFL, the hashes run right down where the pipes are for the uprights. In college, they're a few yards outside of that, so that when you're lined up to one side, you have more of a field to work with.
Oh, what a shot.
Boy, that was a really nice form tackle.
That was a blast by Isaac Ava.
And what I love about this, watch how Ava keeps his head up and wraps through the tackle.
Cool.
You see how low he was? That is not targeting. Gets down. His face is up. He hits the player in his chest. That's just a nice physical tackle there by Ava. And, you know, a lot of people say, oh, with this targeting penalty, it's going to make the game less physical. Was that any less physical than if he would have led with his head and gone for the helmet of the other player?
Great.
That's as physical as it gets.
To the sideline and incomplete, juggled and dropped by Kanan Severin. Dargan was out there on the coverage. Good to see him back in the ball game. But Severin, that was a pass he could have caught.
Just go back to the hash marks. You know, in college football, if you're lined up on the left or the right side of the hashes. So now, if the NFL, the ball would be set here. So you don't have as much field to the right. So the way Oregon, a lot of these spread teams hurt you is they overload the wider side of the field. The NFL, much more difficult to do that.
Pressure coming. Lambert hangs in there, throws too high. And they will turn it over on downs. Two college football's greatest teams square off under the lights for the last time in Ann Arbor, Michigan. It's the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame against the Wolverines of Michigan, at least for the foreseeable future, the last time these two teams will meet. That's really some kind of shame. College football's primetime presented by Hampton Hotels tonight at 8 Eastern on ESPN and watch ESPN.
And that's, people that's will casualty tell you, of the yeah, expansion.
And
that's
people will tell you one of the great things about college football is the history and tradition. What can be more historical and traditional than facing an opponent like that year after year, and yet we're just seeing these rivalries disappear.
How about Texas, Texas A&M?
Crazy.
We don't know the next time we're going to see that. And as a matter of fact, there's so much bad blood between them now that A&M's gone to the SEC. I doubt they're going to schedule each other, and that's a shame. And
that's going to be one of those deals where the state legislature demands that they play. Jake Rodriguez will get a chance to play. He's out of Rockland, California, 6'3 freshman.
And Oregon's still trying to figure out who's number two between Rodriguez and Lockie, so Rodriguez now getting his run.
Those are nice problems to have when most of your other issues are settled.
You know, getting to talk to Mark Helfrich this week, and I took some flack on a studio show back in May when I said that Oregon was going to take a couple steps back. I'm not sure this is a 12-0 team. I'm not sure what I've seen says that this is a team that's going to run it out, go win the championship in the Pac-12 and play for the champion for the national championship. But being around Coach Helfrich, getting to know this program, I don't think they're going to take a step back. I'm not sure that, again, I don't know that they're good enough to go 13-0. They may be. Haven't seen it yet. But Helfrich seems like the right guy. And you mentioned with Rich Brooks. Rich Brooks goes and hires Mike Lotti, a guy that nobody really knew who he was. He was offensive coordinator. They promote him to head coach. And then they really start to take off. Then Chip Kelly, they go get him from the East Coast at offensive coordinator, put him in as head coach. They take off. Now Mark Helfrich, guy who came back to Oregon. He's from Oregon, was at Colorado, came up in the Boise State system with Dirk Cutter at Arizona State, started his career as a graduate assistant at Oregon under Bilotti. And it just feels like that continuity is just going to keep going.
And they don't bring guys in as head coaches. They bring them in as coordinators. They like to talk about the Oregon way and the culture. And they have developed it and developed it. And once you've got something like that going, there's no reason to do it any other way.
And the thing about Oregon, when you look at them, they look like everything's new, everything's flashy. They probably just put their football program together 15, 20 years ago, and oh boy, here they are. But you literally go back to 1977 when Rich Brooks got to Oregon. I've gotten to know Coach Brooks through the years. You can't say enough about the program that he's built and the durability of it. Yes, they have made improvements, huge improvements in their stadium, in their infrastructure, with their training facilities. The uniforms obviously are special and a big part of this, but it goes back to that base built by Brooks.
Ayele to the outside, and he's got enough for a first down for the Ducks. Well, the season comes down to this for NASCAR. Jimmy Johnson ahead of the pack with the chase just 1 week away. The final shot to lock up a spot. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Richmond tonight at 7 Eastern on ABC. Jimmy Johnson, Clint Bowyer at the top. Kevin Harvick, Carl Edwards tied for third in the standings right now.
If you're an Oregon fan,
full start,
and you're a NASCAR,
5 yards. Third down.
If you're an Oregon fan and you're a NASCAR fan, this would be a pretty good weekend to come to Central Virginia, wouldn't it?
You could pretty much determine you could leave in the third quarter. It's about 50 miles to Richmond. Yep. Get out of here and be there in time for the race. A pretty good weekend, you're right. And even better, you could have hitched a ride in the equipment truck and saved yourself the airfare.
I'm not sure they're heading up through Richmond to get back to Oregon. But why not? If you're going that many miles, what's another?
Sure. What's another 50?
Yeah. Just do it.
Well, hats off to the Ducks. They came in here and run their record to 2-0. Virginia very hopeful after a win over a good BYU team. But as we said at the beginning, those Cougars and these Ducks, an entirely different animal.
These Ducks, I'm a University of Washington graduate. These Ducks are so much different than what we had in the 80s and 90s. This is a really impressive program that has been built out in Eugene.
How about Virginia? The optics of this don't look good. You get hammered.
I think they have to forget the score because you kind of knew this might get out of hand. I think their quarterback, David Watford, showed some promise. I'm not sure offensively they have the skill players to really compete in this league. But I think defensively, I think they're going to scare some people. I think this defensive front for Virginia can play with just about anybody. I think David Dean in the middle is a really good defensive tackle. I think they have some things to build on.
Started quickly for Oregon. Mariota went right up the middle for a long run to make it 7-0. They just kept pouring it on except for a little bit of a comeback for the Virginia Cavaliers. But too little, too late. Let's check in with Janine.
Coach, congratulations. How does it feel to be 2-0 as a head coach?
Well, better than any other number, I guess. But a great effort by our guys. I thought we played really, really hard. Didn't play as smart as we need to going forward. Incredible representation by our fans here today and a good win. It'll be a short ride home.
Now, what do you mean you didn't play quite as smart? I know you were not sure exactly what you were going to see from Virginia. How do you feel you did reacting and adjusting?
In that regard, we did very well. Too many penalties, you know, too much stuff that we could control that we have to take care of. But it's always more fun to correct that after a win than after a loss.
Thanks, Mark. Congratulations.
Coach, congratulations. Janine, thank you very much. Another great job down on the field. Oregon wins it. The final here from Charlottesville in front of a big crowd. A disappointing day for Virginia as they fall to Oregon 59-10. For Ed Cunningham and Janine Edwards and our entire crew, this is Mike Patrick. Thanks for watching, everybody. Now back to the studio.